Hey everybody, David here, and this is another Fantasy Age tutorial. Now in this particular tutorial, we're going to look at a couple specialized types of combat in your Fantasy Age game. And it's going to be mounted combat and flying combat. Both of them are pretty much straightforward, easy to incorporate in your games, so let's go ahead and get started first with mounted combat. Now mounted combat is just like it sounds. You're on a land mount, whether it be a drake, a horse, a turtle, any kind of land mount that you can think of, and whatever, of course, what you can get and what is offered by your game master. So there are some rules, but first I want to take a look at a talent, because there is sort of like a hidden note that should be with all of the mechanics that you can see here in mounts and combat, all of these rules here. There's something that I want to show you that's hidden in the talent that was probably accidentally left out and can actually cause a little bit of a confusion for mounted combat. So you can see here there is a note, and this says that two-handed weapons and longbows cannot be properly used on horseback by anyone, not just those with this talent. And if you attempt using the two-handed weapons or a longbow, the damage would be counted as basically improvised weapons. So, meaning you can use any kind of one-handed combat, you could probably use a short bow, but when it comes to the longbows and the two-handed weapons, no matter who you are, if you have this mounted combat style talent or not, damage is going to be counted as improvised weapons. So I just wanted to show you that note first. That probably should be added into this main set of rules here. So let's go ahead and take a look at these rules. First off, the first couple deal with movement. Now, whenever you mount or dismount a horse or any type of land mount, we're going to, for this instance, and you know, for this tutorial, we'll say that you just have a horse. So if you mount or dismount your horse, it's going to cost you a move action. And if you do so, if you say if you mount or dismount, then afterwards you can only use half your speed and movement in yards. And because a move action normally lets you take all of your speed and movement, but let's say if you get off of your horse, that's going to take half your movement, and say if you have a speed of 14, then you'll have 7 yards left to move normally. So that's what this first rule means. Now the second rule is once you're mounted. Now once you're mounted, you can use the move and the run actions as normal, but you use the speed of the mount instead of your own. So you know, if you have that, you know, that 14 speed, your mount is probably going to have a speed that is higher than yours, probably 20. We'll just say 20 for, you know, for the tutorial's sake. So for once you're mounted, you'll take that mounted speed, which would be 20, and you could use a move action once you're mounted, and you can move 20, or you could use the run action, which would be a major action, which would allow you to basically buck the horse that you're on, speed the horse up, and you would get double a horse's movement, so it would go to 40. So just remember, move is a minor action, and you can move up to the mount speed, and then run is a major action, and you can move double the mount speed. And remember, your speed has nothing to do with it when you're mounted, only the speed of the mount. So next let's take a look at about some combat rules. Now first is when you're engaged in combat, you will get a +1 bonus just on the attack roll versus any opponent on foot. Now the GM may rule that this doesn't apply versus particularly large creatures. And as you can see over here on the left hand side, I have a grid. Now I have Gimli. Say he's on his trusty horse, on his steed. He runs up and he's going to attack the bandit that is on foot. Now the bandit is a, you know, it's a medium size, your standard medium creature. So while Gimli is on the mount, his ram, he's going to have the advantage. So therefore, as a game master, I would allow this +1 bonus only to attack rolls versus the bandit that would be on foot. Now, if you take the bandit away and you have this huge hulking zombie there, you know, the big hulking zombie, it is a much larger, and it encompasses much, you know, much more mass, much more area on both theatrically and on this virtual tabletop, and its height would be a lot taller as well. So seeing that that is happening, the zombie is basically not looking up at, you know, Gimli that's on the ram. He's basically probably going to be looking eye level. So as a game master, I'm going to make sure that this rule does not apply because of the particularly large size of the zombie Hulk. So that's what this rule means here. So let's go ahead and move on. I figured that the grid with the tokens would actually kind of help you out, and so you could visually see it. Now, when you when many mounts, okay, now this is about your mount attacking this next one. Now it says many mounts do not have attacks of their own because they're just simply not trained to fight. You know, like riding horses, maybe a turtle, all those special kind of mounts. So those that do have attacks would take those attacks on your turn and around. And it says that you do not need to roll initiative separately for the mount. So if you have a mount that does not attack, horse, turtle, whatever, it just simply doesn't attack. But if you have something like, maybe if you're riding like a land drake, all right, then, or maybe you're maybe riding a panther or something, then if that creature gets like a claw or a bite attack, then that mount would take their attacks or attack on your turn, and then it would use your initiative. So, you know, save a little bit of time. You don't have to roll separate initiatives. Just go off of yours, and everything is good. So, now remember, this is also about getting attacked. Now remember, enemies can choose to attack your target, you know, your mount as their target. So be wary of that, be careful of that, and you are going to need to keep track of your mount's health or hit points. So, you know, if I was fighting someone on horseback, and if they kept charging past me, you're darn right, I'm probably going to be trying to take out that mount. So you just need to be careful, because if you get dismounted, you can basically be knocked prone. You'll probably take some type of falling or penetrating damage as well. Which leads into the next rule that we're going to talk about, and that's using the knock prone stunt to try to dismount you. Now normally, when you use the 2-point knock prone stunt, you're automatically knocked prone. There's no type of contest, there's no, you know, even though there's no saving throw in this game, in Fantasy Age, there would be no type of contest to make sure that you're not knocked prone. But when you are on a mount, on horseback or whatever you're on, your land combat mount, now you're going to have a contest, because you're just not going to automatically be knocked off if you spend those 2 points. So what's going to happen is the person that is trying to knock you off of your mount is going to make you do a dexterity riding test. Now it'll be 3d6 plus dexterity, and if you have the riding ability focus, you can add that small +2 bonus, and which is going to do nothing but help you anyway. So the target number that you're going to have to hit or beat is going to be equal to 10 plus your opponent's strength that's trying to knock you off. So if your opponent's strength is 5, then your target number is 15. That's going to be pretty tough. So you would do a 3d6 plus your dexterity plus any kind of riding ability focus bonus, you'd have to beat that 15. Now, if you make your test, everything is good to go, nothing happens, you just take damage for whatever the hit was from, knock prone doesn't affect you, you continue on. Now, if you fail, you're going to be knocked down to the ground. You're going to take 1d6 penetrating damage, and if you don't know what penetrating damage is, it is damage that negates any kind of armor rating that you have. So usually in Fantasy Age, you would take, if you rolled a 1d6 for penetrating damage, and say that you just rolled a 6, normally armor factor would take that out. So if you have a 5 armor factor and you took 6 damage, you would normally take 1 damage because the armor factor mitigates 5 of it out. But in Fantasy Age, penetrating damage negates all armor factor. So you would take that 6 damage and ignore whatever armor factor you have. It don't matter if you have a 2 armor factor or a 10 armor factor from heavy plate. You're going to take that 6 pure penetrating damage. And whenever you take that damage, you're now going to be knocked prone. So now you're going to have to use your movement to stand up, and then the rest of your speed is going to be hampered because you stood up. Now, when you get knocked prone, you take your penetrating damage. The GM now controls the action of your mount until you either catch up to it and remount it, or the encounter ends. Straightforward, I like it. Now, here's when you're dealing with passengers. Passengers do not have to worry about move and run actions. Simply put, they're carried along. They don't have any say on move or run. So I like this. They're just along for the ride, basically. Now, they can take their actions as normal, but the GM should bear in mind, you know, situational type of things that are going to happen. So, passengers, their speed doesn't matter. They're along for the ride. They take their actions as normal. They roll their own initiative and whatnot. All is good there. Now, all of these rules, very end here, all of these rules also apply when driving a vehicle like a cart or a wagon. Now, if you're trying to do the knock prone stunt, instead of using dexterity riding, you're going to need to use strength driving for tests instead. Makes sense. Now, if knock prone is used against a passenger of a vehicle, much like a passenger that's on the back of the horse, then that, you know, person will need to use dexterity acrobatics to resist, you know, still with the same TN of 10 plus the opponent's strength. Now, let's take a look at this mounted combat style talent, which is a way that you can customize your character. There are many different talents, and mounted combat style is just one of them. Of course, you know, we already talked about warrior only, and you need to have the dex riding focus. And, you know, like I said, this note, it should be over here with the mounted combat rules. But as if you take mounted combat style, you're going to start as a novice. And this is where you can use the mobility of your mount to your advantage in combat. So when mounted and making a move action, you can move part of your allowed distance, then use your major action to maybe make a melee attack, and then you can use the rest of your movement to your maximum allowed distance. Straightforward. The total distance moved cannot be more than your mount speed. Normally you'd have to finish moving before attacking, but as a novice in mounted combat style, it basically allows you to make your movement like Dungeons and Dragons 5th edition, where you can use part of your movement, make an attack, and then move again. I really like that. That's a very nice novice level talent. It's very nice. Now, when you take Journeyman, this is where your mounted charge is fearsome, and you can move at your mount's full speed when making a charge action and inflict plus 1 damage if your attack strikes home. So now, instead of just having a plus 1 to hit as Journeyman, as long as you are making the charge action, then you can go ahead and inflict a plus 1 damage to your attack if it hits. Very nice. Now, for Master, it says you and your mounts are as one. The knock-prone stunt cannot dismount you. So, remember we talked about the test. You're going to be doing that riding test? Well, not anymore. Once you become Master, you cannot be knocked off. Now, your passenger can, but you won't be able to. Pretty nice. I think if you're going to play a lot of mounted combat in your Fantasy Age game, then you definitely want to take a look at mounted combat style. So there you go, everybody. That's mounted combat, and now we're going to go ahead and continue with flying.
Flying
combat
can be just a little bit more confusing, but we'll still go over it really slow
and we'll make sure everybody gets it. So, flying combatants, just like it sounds. Maybe you're flying a Drake, maybe you're flying a Griffin, maybe you're flying with a ring of flying, maybe you're using a potion of flying. All different types of ways you can fly. So, this is where some combatants have the ability to fly. These are mostly going to be monsters, but you, the PC, are going to have your opportunity to fly once in a while, and you may get access to a mount or magic that's going to let you fly. So here are the rules. They may be a little confusing, but they do make sense, I promise. So flight is going to be indicated parenthetically after the character's speed. Normally, your character will not have your flying speed in parentheses because you are the ones that make the character. So, here's how to calculate your speed. It's really easy. A character with a speed of 6 will basically 6 yards will double, and that will be your flying speed. So, if you have a movement of, we'll say, 10 yards, you double that, your flying speed in parentheses will be 20 yards. If you're, you know, playing theatrically 10 yards, it's pretty good ways. If you're playing on a virtual tabletop or a game map, that's 10 squares. That's a pretty good distance. So, excuse me. Now, there's going to be the way that it's handled here in Fantasy Age is the use of 4 different actions. There are 2 minor actions and 2 major actions. All right. You have to use one of these actions on your turn when you're flying. And you have to use one. And you can only use one in conjunction with maybe a minor action or major action like attacking. So I reiterate again, this is what's going to happen. When you are flying, you have to take one of these 4 actions: circle, fly, dive, or fly high. You have to take one of those 4. And you can only take one of those 4 every round you're flying. So let's get that out of the way. Makes perfect sense when you kind of, you know, read it a couple times. Because if you don't take one of these every single round, then that means you start to fall. And if you fall, the game master's probably going to have a lot of fun with you, because in Chapter 8, in the Master and the Rules section where it has all the hazard damage can get pretty high, up to 66. And then, you know, depending on how high you are, the GM can even go higher than 66, you know, as long as the DM is being, or the GM is being fair with that. So you have to take one of the 4 actions of flying. You have to. And when you do that, you can only take one. Pretty straightforward. I think we're ready to move on. So, the 4 actions, all right, are circle, fly, dive, and fly high. Now, we are going to take a look at these one by one. We'll start with the minor actions first. The first one is, we're going to start with fly first, because I think even though fly is on the bottom, I think we're going to start with fly first, because this is how you actually start to fly. So if you're on the ground, you take your minor action, you now start to fly. All right, this is where you can move a distance equal to your flying speed. Now, when you use the fly action, this is where the character is roughly 3 yards off of the ground and can be attacked in melee by opponents on the ground. So be careful. When you start to fly, you are susceptible to being hit with attacks. Okay? Now, you know, the character, you are also going to be able to attack. So seeing that fly takes a minor, you can be hovering those 3 yards and you can still attack down on people. And when you do this, you're going to receive a +1 bonus to melee attack rolls. Pretty straightforward. Pretty straightforward. Reason why, you have the advantage. You know, just like Anakin. I've got the high ground, Anakin!
Don't do it. But anyways, you'll have the high ground. You'll get a plus one on your attack roll. All right. After you attack, you can choose the land. You know, if you can choose the land, which then again, you'll be able to start doing more things on the ground again, like charging, moving, or run actions. Because when you're flying, you can't charge. There's no more charging. Charging's for, you know, people on the ground. That's why there's the special actions. So it starts to really make sense when you start reading all of these. And it's actually pretty good. It's quite abstract, but it's still pretty good. So I hope I'm not losing you guys so far. So the next minor action is circling. All right, this is where the flying character circles above the battlefield at a low altitude, moving a number of yards equal to their flying speed. Ranged attacks from the ground will add 20 yards to the horizontal distance from the shooter to the target to represent the height of the flyer. And a circling character can attack other circling characters at no penalty. A character must start their turn either flying to circle, basically flying or circling. So you have to start with either flying or circling. You know, you have to. I mean, that's pretty straightforward. Now, there are some things that you got to take into consideration as well. Other things like knocking prone, because if you are circling, you're still within range. And remember, the creature on the ground is going to have that 20 yards added to the horizontal, you know, distance. But in the grand scheme of things, bows have a pretty long range. So you're going to have to worry about that. But don't worry, because the knockdown stunt does not work like it does with mounted combat. You're not going to be thrown off of your mount. Not going to do that. You're not going to fall to your death. And I like the way that they do this for flying. So if you do have that two stunt point knock prone stunt successfully hit on you, then your flying speed is basically, you know, reduced by three. And it's reduced by three until the end of, you know, their next turn. So really easy. So if you have that, you know, if you have that 20 speed that we were talking about, 10 on the ground, 20 in the air, if you get hit by, you know, the knock prone stunt, your 20 is going to go down to a 17 until the end of their next turn. All right, pretty straightforward. It's not a huge hindrance, but you know, it is a hindrance, but it's not that bad. So now we've looked at circle and flying. Those are the minor actions. Let's take a look at the major actions. Now, we'll go ahead and take a look at, we're going to take a look at dive first. All right. Now, this is where a character that was circling or flying high, all right. In fact, we'll probably do flying high first, because I think it would probably make more sense to do flying high first, because diving is sort of like the last thing that you can do before the whole thing will repeat itself. So let's take a look at fly high. So this is where the character can move a number of yards equal to their flying speed while climbing far above the battlefield. While flying high, the character cannot attack or cannot be attacked. Even if there's other, you know, characters flying high, you just simply cannot be attacked and you cannot attack anyone. Now, when you fly high, a character must start their turn circling to fly high. All right? So you have to be circling first before you fly high. When you fly high, you jet up to your flying speed. Nothing can attack you. You can't attack them. Now, you're probably out of range of everything, all right? Because you can't be attacked. Makes sense. So the last thing that you can do is dive. That's the major action. And this is where a character that was circling or flying high the previous round, because remember, you only can do one of these special actions a round. This is where you can dive this round. Now, a character that was circling can move a number of yards equal to flying speed and make a melee attack against an opponent on the ground. So if you're circling, you can dive, and you can get an attack on an opponent on the ground. A character who was flying high, which is what we just talked about, basically can move a number of yards equal to double their flying speed because they were flying high. And they're going to get, if they take double their movement, you know, they're going to get to take a melee attack also. But in either case, whether if you were circling or if you're flying high, you're going to get a plus one bonus on the melee attack roll and a plus one bonus damage on your damage roll. Easy, pretty straightforward. Now, at the end of the dive, everything kind of resets, and this is where your character is roughly 3 yards off the ground, just like they had taken the fly action. So now you revert back to where you started flying, which is the fly minor action. Makes sense, doesn't it? I mean, it really does. I had to read this about 4 or 5 times before I actually got it. But it does make sense. Like I said, it is very abstract. There's not rules for every little tick-tacky thing about flying, but that's okay. Fantasy Age is not mechanically made to do that. You know, some of this is going to be up to the GM interpretation also. So, I do like flying. Read it a couple times. But, you know, hey, you start flying, then you can circle, then you fly high, and then you dive. It's a multiple round process, but in the end, it reverts back to the start. The fly minor action. Straightforward. I really like it. So, there you go, everybody. Hope I didn't confuse you. Anyways, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you enjoyed it. Please feel free to leave a comment down below. And also, if you haven't done so yet, please subscribe to the YouTube channel. Like the video, share it, do all kinds of stuff. So, anyways, I'm out of here. I got something to do. What do I got to do? I don't know. Probably another tutorial. So, anyways, see you next time.